Before starting the session, let me tell you the very objective of this session. We are actually going to launch, in current affairs review, we are going to launch one course on sociology, right? The course, you can view the course details from this particular link. Okay, you can easily view the course details from this link. I'm also giving it on the chat. Now, not only this, obviously, as a result, you can expect that I'll be introducing the subject sociology to you. And not only that, I'm actually dividing the session into two halves, because a number of students here, they are my old students who are here. I do see Srishti, I do see Sankalp, Durga Prasad, Sanket, number of my old students, I can see them, Raghavendra. So the session would be divided into two parts. First part, I'll be introducing sociology as a subject to you. And in the second part, those who are my old students and also those who are joining new, if you have any question, you can easily ask your questions to me. I'll be happy to answer your questions. Okay, so first I'm going to introduce sociology as a subject to you, right? That's the first part of the discussion. Let's start from there. Now, what is sociology all about? This particular subject that we are talking about, what is sociology? Or rather, what is the subject matter of sociology? See, none of you, those who are my old students, they already know this, and those who are new here, none of you are completely alien to sociology. No, sociology is one subject which all of you know something about it. Okay? Because you're born in the society. Sociology is about the society. It's a study of the society. Study of human society. That's what sociology is. The very genesis of sociology was from the crisis that started happening within the society and how to address that crisis. Right? So genesis of sociology, as we look at, so the genesis of sociology was to deal with the crisis originating in society. Someone, one stalwart by the name Saint Simon, he was of the opinion that you can only understand this crisis, the crisis that is originating in sociology, if you study the society first. If you study the society, then only you can answer the problems of society. It is from there that sociology as a subject originated, right? So what can be the subject matter of society or sociology? Say things like religion, say things like politics, say things like the legal system, so things like social change, or change for that matter, change in society, you must say. In fact, change is one of the major key ingredients of sociology. Not only this, also there are certain common areas which are common between sociology and social anthropology, like marriage, like family system, like kinship systems. Kinships means relatives or relations. Not only blood relations and affinal relations, both. Conjugal and consanguineal, both. Conjugal means marriage relations. People with whom you have relation because of your marriage. Say your father-in-law, mother-in-law, your husband, your brother-in-law, your sister-in-law, those people, they come from conjugal relationship. Okay? And consanguineal, those with whom you have your relationship because of your birth relation, blood relations, you may say. Clear? So even those aspects, they all come within the subject matter of sociology. Now, just look at these subject matters and tell me, don't you think that when you were born in the society, from there itself, you have been exposed to these tendencies? You have been looking at religion. You have been looking at politics happening in society. You have been looking at the legal system. You have been looking at various changes. Yes, when you were young, number of changes were not there. Today, those changes are happening. Marriage. Even within marriage, today we are talking about love marriage. We are talking about live-in relationship. So many changes. Family system is changing. Previously, we used to talk about joint families. Today, it's nuclear families. Right? So many changes are happening. And you are witness to everything. And that's what the subject matter of sociology is. But there is a difference. Difference between common sense and sociological study. Sociology is not about common sense. The idea that you have, quite often than not, those ideas are marred by common sense. Say tomorrow, all of a sudden, say a person comes to your gate, rings the calling bell, and you see the person is standing with his chest, with his broad chest, all feathers on the top of the head, and a spear in his hand. What will you do? You'll immediately shut the door out of fear. Why? Do you know whether that man is there to kill you? No. Then why were you fearful? That's the difference between common sense and sociology. In sociology, we do go for in-depth and detailed study. Okay? So, that's where the problem is. Pranesh Gazmer, you have commented that you can't hear. Pranesh, the audio from this side is proper. I think there is some problem with your own settings. Okay, let's go on from there itself. So that is sociology. That is a subject matter of sociology. What we were talking about here. I tried to elaborate things in a far more broader way so that you get the very essence of sociology. Okay, not only that, simultaneously, I would also like to talk about that how, see, here itself you can understand that sociology or no one here, whomsoever you are, whether you are from science background, whether you're from commerce background, whether you're from arts background, it doesn't matter. Sociology as a subject is not completely alien to you. But there would be certain problems. You being here, wherever you're from, say for example, just now I saw someone, Pranesh Gazmer. Pranesh must be from Rajasthan, right? Similarly, I do look at, yes, Durga Prasad is there. Durga Prasad is from Orissa. Dipankar is there. Dipankar is from West Bengal. Raghavendra is from Andhra Pradesh, right? So you are from different places. Now, say for example, in marriage, are the systems of marriage in all the places of India just the same? There are certain things common, but there are a number of things which are different as well, especially in the marriage relations, right? So in sociology, I'll be looking at all those various types, the various angles. Clear? That's what I'm going to do. That's how I'm going to approach. So here, number one, no one is an alien. We all know something or the other about sociology, and that's why it is very easy for us to grasp it. And we are actually going to, my job here as a teacher is going to be to put your perspective, to put what you know in the right angle, in the right perspective. Okay? And at the same point of time, to also provide you with additional informations. You already know something, but that may not be sufficient enough. That may not be everything. So there, I'll be giving you something additional as well. That's what my job is going to be here. Fine. Durga Prasad has asked a question. Let's look at the question first before going any further forward. How can we approach? I'll be coming to that particular point, Durga Prasad, that how can we approach sociology optional syllabus from starting of the syllabus to ending of the syllabus. Marriage system is common in India, but rituals behind the marriage is different. Absolutely. And marriage system, if we say, it's not completely common in every particular corner of India. Right? Marriage system at different corners of India are different. Okay? Say, marriage among the Hindus, marriage among the Muslims, marriage among the Sikhs, I do see difference in that. And even marriage in northern India, marriage in southern India, there are differences. So we would be looking at all those differences while going forward with the topic. Not only that. Now, how scoring, before going that, I would like to take up that how am I going to approach the subject of sociology. Okay, I would like to complete my discussion first and then I'll be looking at the comments. Subsequently, whomsoever you would be commenting, your comment will be there. Once I complete my discussion, then only I'll be looking at those comments. Okay. Because or else my flow gets disturbed. So let's go forward from here. Now, how am I going to approach sociology? See, there are quite a few myths about sociology. Again and again, people say that sociology is all about thinkers. You have to study the thinkers. You have to mark the thinkers. You have to remember so many names of the thinkers. Sorry, but no. Sociology is a story. My approach to sociology is going to be like a storytelling. I'll be telling you the story and I'll be requesting you or I'll be expecting from you that you will know the story by heart, not mug it. Understand it. That's what my approach is going to be. What I'm going to do, yes, in sociology, there are thinkers and the thinkers are important. Thinkers are important in every possible subject. Because the thinkers help us to understand how to approach the subject. Here in sociology, we have six pioneering thinkers. Who helps us in understanding how to approach the subject. Yes, I will be starting with these thinkers first. I'll go for these thinkers first. Right? At first, I'll try to understand what sociology is. Once I've understood what sociology is, I'll be going for these six pioneering thinkers. Along with these six pioneering thinkers, there are three Indian thinkers. While studying them, time and again, I'll be telling you not to mug them, not to cram, not to ratify, but to understand them. Because UPSC's question or questions which would be asked by UPSC would be from your understandings. So by mugging, you would not be able to answer those questions. Know the thinkers. Understand them. Listen to my stories and understand them. Okay? That's what my approach is going to be. So that's how I'm going to go forward. I'm going to take up these nine thinkers in a way where you understand them. Once that is done, once you've understood the thinkers, then subsequently I'll be taking up one subject after another from the other topics. Say, for example, then I'll be going for stratification. Stratification means the way the society is divided. Say the castes, say the classes, upper class, upper middle class, lower middle class, lower class. That division in society that we look at, that's stratification. Okay, so I'll be looking at those aspects both from the point of paper one and paper two. So whenever I'll be approaching one particular topic, I'll be approaching it in an integrative way. I would not be looking at these topics differently. Why? Because paper one and paper two in sociology are actually not different. They are united. In paper one, we have the theories dealing with these topics, and in paper two, we have their applications in India. So can you separate the theory from the application? No, we cannot. So why to unnecessarily separate them? So that's how I'm going to approach. I'll be going for the thinkers first. After the thinkers, I'll be going for the stratification. After stratification, I'll be taking up family marriage kinship. Right? Again, both paper one and paper two. And you do know why. Because again, even here as well, paper one would be talking about the theories. But to understand the theories without example, it's not possible. Because I told you, I'll be going for storytelling. And I would request you to listen to my stories and listen to them very carefully. That's what my approach is going to be. Right? So, yes, I would be going for both paper one and paper two in an integrated way. After this, I'll be taking up work and economic life. This is only in paper one, this particular topic. So there's no point in writing paper one and paper two. Then I'll be going for politics and society. Again, both paper one and paper two. Then I'll be going for religion and society. Again, both paper one and paper two. Then I'll be going for social change. Social change and movements, both paper one and paper two. Okay. And once this is done, then I'll be taking up the remaining aspects like research methodology. Population dynamics, these type of things. Okay, so that's how I'm going to approach the syllabus. And obviously, all the time when approaching, my primary concern would be to fill in with what you already know. I'll be taking out what you already know from you only, and I'll be putting additional input with that. So, really, believe me, this is one subject which you already know about because you are born in that subject and you have been growing within the subject matter of this. You're both born and you have grown within this subject matter. Right? And here in this particular module, we are going to approach this subject in two particular ways. We are going to go for not only understanding of the theories, but I'm also going to go for the previous year's questions continuously. We'll be raising those questions and we'll be writing answers of those questions. Because without writing practice, see, in sociology, one thing is there. Number one, you have to understand the things and then you have to be able to write them, write what you understand in your own words. So your own writing is going to be very important. And it is not only about sociology, it is also about GS. In GS as well, the way questions are being asked, they would expect you to understand the phenomena and then write on your own. So for the examination conducted by UPSC, your own writing is going to be very important. Writing in English language is going to be very important. So yes, within this subject will be working very hard in improving your writing skills. That's where we are going to work from the very first day onwards. Okay. The total class duration is going to be of 90 hours, 90 to 100 hours, right? Within this 90 to 100 hours, we are going to complete the class at least. But our association would be long enough till you are giving the examination. Till your last attempt, I'll be there by your side. That's one thing for sure. It's not that once the class is over, our association ends there. Those who are my old students, they already know that. Right? I try to answer your queries to the best of my ability, wherever I can, whatever time I do get, I try to give that time to you people. Clear? So, my total attention would be in that respect. That till you're giving attempts, I will be there by your side, holding your hand. And again and again, I'm saying this, that we would be truly focusing on writing practice. Now, when I'm saying writing practice, the way we will be developing our writing skill would not only be required for sociology, but would also be required for GS, as I've already said. Right? So in that way, we are going to work. Simultaneously, let's see how scoring is sociology. This is one subject with which even this last time the result that came out, we have seen that 200 plus students, they have qualified. This particular subject is giving the maximum number of results. If you're taking sociology, there is no reason for you, and the way I'll be approaching, there is no reason for you not to score 250 and above. So 250 above in optional, you can easily understand, you are way ahead of others. And if you truly work hard, there is no reason for you not to score something close to 300 or above 300. So 300 is actually the 60% mark. And it's very much possible with this subject to score that 60% mark. Right? That's what sociology is. That's how scoring sociology is. And sociology, if you go through these subjects properly, if you go through these topics properly, something additional happens. You know what? Number one, your Indian society topics, they get thoroughly covered. Number two, your essay gets thoroughly covered. If you're lucky enough, both your essays would be from this subject only. And simultaneously, obviously in interview as well, we do get an edge in with sociology as an optional. That's the reason why sociology gives maximum number of results in the recent times. If you look at the trend of the results, this is one subject which is giving the maximum number of results. That's why. Right now, when it comes to materials and books, I must admit that the notes that I'll be giving, along with IGNU material, which I'll be continuously keeping on supplying you, other than that, I don't expect you to go through anything else. If you join the course with me, only the things that I will be giving, I'll be supplying you with some PDFs continuously. I will be supplying you with some NCRTs as well, with some chapters of NCRTs, not the whole of the NCRTs. Those chapters of NCRT, along with the other PDFs that I will be supplying, I don't expect you to go through anything else. So one thing is here, you don't have to care about materials. What you have to care about is to study them while understanding them. Again and again, I'm saying, please don't try to mug, whether in sociology as an optional or in GS. This is not your university exam. Here, by mugging, you would not be able to score. What you need to do is, you need to understand. Simply, say whatever I'm saying. Can you understand that? If you can understand that, fine. Now, write about it in your own words. That's what you have to do. That's what the approach of sociology is going to be. That's what my approach is going to be. Clear? Now I'm going to take up the questions from all the people. I have nearly done. Actually, by the way, The fees, officially we have kept the fees at 10,000. Okay, 10,000 for this optional subject. But those who are my former students, those who are my old students, for them I would request you, okay, please contact me separately. You all have my number. Those who are my old students, you have my number. Contact me. I would like to talk to you about this. Okay. So the fees we have kept, the fee structure we have kept at 10,000 rupees. And this is going to be a holistic and grueling 90 to 100 hours class. Right. We are starting the class from 5th of August, and I expect to end the class by early September only. So that, why early September? So that you get the remaining time in your hands to concentrate only on prelims. Right? That's what I'm trying to do. So that you also get sufficient amount of time. Say, during the time we'll be doing the class, that should be sufficient enough for you. That way I'll be elaborating the class. Okay, once I'm elaborating in the class, once you're listening to me in the classes will be of 3 hours a day. In these 3 hours, the way I'll elaborate the topic, the way I'll be elaborating the subject, if you listen to me carefully, and simultaneously the video of every class will be accessible to you for next 24 hours. Okay. After 24 hours, those videos will be deleted. Okay. So once the class is held, for next 24 hours, you'll be having the video. Go through the video, look at the video, and then subsequently the video will be gone. Okay. So that way as well, you can carry on with the class. Clear? What I'm expecting is, once you attend these classes, after that you should not require any additional time for optional. Give me these 3 hours and that should be sufficient enough. The rest of the time, give it to your preparation for GS. That's what I'm expecting from you. Now I'm taking the questions. Durga Prasad has written something. Okay. Please point out chapters from NCERT books, which is important. Well, chapters from NCERT books means, Durga Prasad, what I'll do, I'll actually be giving the PDFs of those chapters. Right now, intentionally, you can understand this is an open session. Intentionally, I'm not pointing out the chapters here. Right? But while in the class, I'll be continuously giving you those chapters. I'll be taking out those PDFs. Because in NCERT, you know the chapter-wise PDFs are available. I'll give you those chapters. I'll give you those PDFs. These are the PDFs. Take it and go through those PDFs only. Right? That's how I am going to approach there. Since this is an open session, that's why I'm keeping myself brief here. Because some of you may have already done sociology, but the others may have not. For them, it would become unnecessary burden. What are the chapters to do? All these things I'm saying from bat to gate. That's why I'm trying to keep it as limited as possible. If do you have whatever other questions you have, you can come out with that. Now here, till I wait for your questions, let me just take up one particular topic here, right? I'm just looking at the genesis of sociology, how sociology originated. This is just an example of how I'm going to conduct the class. So the topic I was talking about here, genesis of sociology. See how it's going to be, how the class is going to be. See, this is some 1774 in USA. There would be a revolution starting. A slogan they would give, George Washington, Benjamin Franklin, all these people, they were together, they got together, and they would give a slogan that no taxation without representation. Okay. That's what the slogan would be. And what was actually happening was, Britain was unnecessarily imposing heavy taxes on its colony in USA, in America, was extracting heavy taxes from there, but no one used to listen to the people of that colony. It is from there that the frustrated people of that colony, they came out with the slogan that no taxation without representation. And in 1774, finally, they would come out with the declaration of their independence. They would declare that we are not part of Britain anymore. For 2 years, this fight will go on from 1777 to 1776. Okay, finally, in 1776, they would get their independence. With this American Revolution, the world would come across a new idea called liberty. It's not independence, please. Independence means freedom. Liberty means freedom with responsibilities. Right? This idea, liberty, what happened actually Britain and France, they kept on fighting with each other. They had a very unique relationship. They kept on fighting for each other's colonies. Okay. When this revolution started in Britain, the French, they saw this as an opportunity to hurt the British. When this revolution started in America, this revolution of 1774, the French, they saw this as an opportunity to hurt the British. So the French, they sent their soldiers to America. The French soldiers, they came to America to participate in this American freedom movement. Okay, they would participate and they would see that in America, they're establishing a unique system where it is the people, the common people of America, they are going to be the owner of the country. They are talking about liberty. They are talking about concepts like liberty. They are talking about concepts like republic, where people choose who's going to govern them, where the government is going to listen to the people. This is unheard of. They are talking about democracy. This is unheard of in France itself. Result, when these French soldiers, they would go back. They would go back carrying these three ideas: liberty, republic, democracy. Result, in 1789, in France, we would see a revolution to start, because the French people, they themselves were frustrated by their government, by their king. Right? King Louis the 16th. Who was there in power, Louis the 16th, was practically a worthless king. Right? All the powers were concentrated in the hands of the prime minister, who was the cardinal of France. And the cardinal was just torturing people and exploiting people. When the French soldiers, they would come back from America, they would come back with these particular ideas: liberty, republic, democracy. And they would see that their own brothers and sisters, they're suffering in this way. Their own family is suffering this way. Result, in France, we would see getting influence from the American Revolution. In 1789, there would be a revolution in France. And from that revolution, we would get some ideas. What ideas? Anyone who can help me out here? The idea of right to ask a question. That if we are being governed, why can't we ask questions? We obviously have the right to ask questions from the authority. The authority is not absolute. We have the right to ask them questions. Simultaneously, also the notion of secularism. Okay. The French Revolution would give these ideas. This particular point, right to ask question, would be very dangerous. It would instigate people to ask question about everything. Result, we would see it is from here that a tendency would rise, a tendency to think rationally. Think logically. Okay, that's how the things would be. That's how the things would be going on. Subsequently, we would see from this idea of thinking rationally or thinking logically, Renaissance or Enlightenment would start. And ultimately, this Enlightenment would give way to scientific thinking. And all of these things would start bringing change in the society. Continuously, the society was changing. In Britain, post this scientific thinking, we would see the rise of Industrial Revolution. So one country after another was getting affected by this. First America, then from America, France, then from France, Italy, then from Italy, Britain. Just imagine, one country after another was getting affected by this. There was total chaos everywhere. All the old order was just getting destroyed. It is in this backdrop that the philosophers and thinkers were busy to understand that how can the society be stabilized? What to do so that order comes back? That order can be a new order, doesn't matter, but order has to come back instead of chaos. Because with the old order getting destroyed, there was chaos everywhere. People didn't know what to do. Just imagine, I'm talking about France only here. What would happen in France? 1789, there would be revolution in France and a Republican government would come to power. 1799, that Republican government would be changed and Napoleon Bonaparte would come to power. Continuous change. People don't know what to do. Right? So it is in this backdrop that these philosophers and thinkers, they were thinking how to bring back order. One of the philosophers by the name Saint Simon, he would say that you want to bring order, but you want to bring order in which particular system? You want to bring order in social system. Okay. Now, do you know the society? You want to bring order in the social system, but do you know the society properly? Hardly you know the society. So how come you want to bring order? Know the society first. That was his idea. His disciple, Auguste Comte, he would take idea from here, from Saint Simon, and Auguste Comte would gradually start setting up or establishing the subject of sociology. To study the society. That's how sociology as a subject came up. This is a story of how sociology as a subject got established. Right? In brief, I talked about the genesis of sociology. Now, obviously, I can go forward with the discussion of Auguste Comte. I can talk about Herbert Spencer. I would like to talk about Emile Durkheim. Number of such people, their stories, what they tried to do. Right? These stories only. Now, are these stories so difficult? But that's what sociology is. At least that's how I'm going to approach. That's how my approach is going to be. Was it too difficult for you to understand? Right? I'm looking at a comment. Raghavendra's commented, sir, how we approach answers of first questions as from sociology perspective. See, what current affairs questions which we are looking at, yes, sociology is a very dynamic subject. One change and there would be changes in the understanding of society. Not thoroughly, but there would be some. Say, for example, I'm just looking at, a while back, I was talking about live-in relationship. Na? While talking about marriage, 2012, the Supreme Court of India, they would come out with a verdict, and in the verdict they would say that actually one lady, she was in live-in relationship and she was continuously being tortured by the mother and the sister of a live-in partner. But there was no protection to this live-in partners previously. This lady, she would complain against the mother and the sister of the live-in partner. The issue would went up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court would say that all those protections available under domestic violence laws, Domestic Violence Act, and 498A, all those protections available to a legally married wife under these particular two acts, they would also be available to the live-in partner. Result, the Supreme Court would equate live-in relationship with marriage relations. The whole understanding would get changed. That's how whenever a major change happens, whenever a major development happens, there is certain changes, right? While doing the class, we will incorporate this type of changes, obviously. And there I will elaborate how to incorporate them while writing the answers. Clear? Anything else? I wish, Raghavendra, I have elaborated in front of you that how these topics, they are to be integrated. Say, for example, here, what I'm seeing is, I'm seeing that the marriage relation in India is changing. Say today, when we are talking about Supreme Court, even two particular cases, Nisha Sharma case and Pinky Rani case. Pinky Rani case is of 1993 or 96, I'm not exactly remembering, is of 90s only. Okay. Given these two cases, the Supreme Court said that 498A, in 498A previously, there was a provision for automatic arrest. If a complaint has been lodged under 498A, the FINM accused, they were to be immediately arrested. But given the falsification of the facts in these two cases, the Supreme Court would say that in 498A, there would be no immediate arrest after this. There would be no automatic arrest after this. It is only when the investigating officer, IO, finds that the FINM accused, they are culprit, then only the culprits would be arrested. Only after filing the charge sheet, not before that. Okay? This way, I gave two examples that how with recent developments, things change, how to incorporate them. Clear? So that's how the things are going to be. That's how it should be done. Triple talaq is a topic of polity, but when we, well, triple talaq, absolutely, it is a topic of sociology as well. I'm looking at social empowerment of women, social empowerment of the minority woman. So absolutely, it's a topic of sociology. It's not only a topic of polity only. It's a topic of sociology, it's a topic of Indian society, and simultaneously it's a topic of polity. It's primarily a topic of sociology and Indian society. Okay? So absolutely. Because I'm going to look at the woman of the minority section here and their empowerment, securing their rights. Clear? So yes, sir, Raghavendra, this was Durga Prasad. You're absolutely right. This is a topic of sociology only. Clear? So that's how to approach the subject. I wish I have been able to elaborate it properly. Again, I'm just writing down the. I'm giving you the link once again. The link for the page, right? It's here, and I'm also putting the link once again on the chat section as well, so that you can go to the page. If you want to register, you can easily register for the course. Okay, that's the thing. By the way, my old students, if you want to join, just give me a call. You have my number, you have my WhatsApp number, you have contacts with me, so you can easily contact me, those who are my old students. I would like to talk to you before you join. Okay. That's all, guys. So before ending the class, let me tell you, today in the evening from 6 p.m. onwards, let me stop the video, pause the video here. Okay. So today, today at from 6 p.m. onwards, we are going for a live session in Facebook. That live session would be about the present Iran crisis. We have seen one bomb blast in Iran, and simultaneously there has also been this issue with Chabahar port. You must be knowing that. Because of all these issues, we are going for India-Iran, or rather the Iran crisis as a topic today. I do invite all of you for that session. Okay, that's all, guys. I hope I didn't get any more question. So I hope that all your questions are addressed, all your questions are answered properly, right? So I'm ending the session here itself. Thank you all.